Hi everyone, I'm Sanjana and I have Naveen with me today to talk about B2B freelance content writing. Hi Naveen, thanks much for coming.
Thanks for having me, Sanjana. And I think it's a great opportunity to talk about what I know and help people who are just starting out, basically, and you know, share my expertise.
Exactly, yeah.
So thanks.
And yeah, we are so glad to have you on board. And to give an introduction about Naveen, Naveen is a very successful freelance content writer, and he predominantly works with B2B SaaS companies. And I have worked with Naveen during my Hippo Video days, and the quality of work that Naveen brings out was, you know, exemplary. So I couldn't think of a better person than Naveen to talk about, you know, content writing. So Naveen, welcome again, and we can get started. All right. Yeah, so I have so many questions written down for you, Naveen. But before we start, let's talk a bit about your content writing journey so far. Like, how did you get into this field and what made you pursue your career as a freelancer?
Two parts to that question. First is how I found a career in the B2B content writing space, and why I decided to be a freelancer.
Yeah,
I'll answer the first because it is much easier to explain, and I think most people can relate to. When I was a full-time, I'm basically a computer science graduate, so I did not do any BBA or MBA, but I understand marketing because I have done marketing related writing or writing within the SEO and marketing industry. So when I was a full-time employed person, I had several horrible experiences with bosses, which made it very difficult for me to survive in any job for more than 4 or 5 months.
Okay.
And when I was sort of at a crossroads because I was not having any motivation to work in the technical industry, in the IT services sector. Because I started my career with Infosys as a software trainer, and then I moved on to content writing within Infosys. Before joining Infosys, I had some technical writing experience, and that helped me when I got the content writing role within Infosys.
Okay, okay.
So after, I did that for about eight months. After I left that, I got to a place where I wanted to do writing as my career. I did not want to be in the technical field, either training or coding at all. You know, thought of looking at the code or thought of wanting to write a code, it's outdated for me because I was good at it. Today I pick up, I will still be good at it, but it's not something that I see myself doing 10 years down the line. You know, when people talk about marketing, when people talk about coding software, they have dreams and they have ambitions in that field. I did not have that. So I did not see myself as a natural coder, even though I was quite logical in the way I would write, you know. I would say my commenting on the code was better than actual code.
Okay.
So I loved explaining the technical side of it, not doing the technical stuff as much.
I can relate with you so much because I started my career as a business analyst, and then I moved into content writing in the same company like you did, and I was hired as a business analyst for my understanding of the technical skills, but I was not an executioner. I was not a coder, or I cannot execute, you know, technical skills, but I can understand and explain that. I can explain that in a better way than, you know, write code or write program, whatever. So, you know, but that's how I got into business analyst field. And then I moved into content writing. So I can relate with you so much there.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. And you know, you have worked with several B2B SaaS clients, right? So what's your advice to any beginners who want to get into the content writing field? Like, what advice do you have for beginners?
I would say first, find what you are comfortable with.
Okay.
You know, establish a process to analyze it. So because you are new, you would know it's very difficult for any hiring person to consider you, whether as a full-time writer or even as a freelance writer.
Yeah.
You know, it would be very difficult for them to consider you without samples. So you would need samples. You know?
Yeah.
If you were at their place, you would probably not be hiring for someone where you would be paying without looking at their samples, you know, and just say, yes, I want to do this. Yes, yeah, I can do this. Let's do this. You know, it's not going to work like that. So you would need to come with some kind of leverage, right? Mm-hmm. You would need a way to prove your skills. And the best way to do it is go on Medium and create a own blog of your own, you know. Don't worry about getting paid. Just write there.
Start
create
writing.
A space for yourself. Sample. Start creating samples. Now, coming to the second part, what to create samples about, that depends on you and what you are interested in, where your curiosity flows.
Okay.
You know, because content writing is two part. It's not just writing. It's also content.
Mm-hmm.
So what kind of content you can produce, about what you can produce, will depend on what you can be excited about and what you can think about. You know, as a technical person, I was still doing technical stuff, but I was not enjoying it. But when I got my first SEO and marketing client, it was ghostwriting, but it was just before EngageBay. It was in late November 2017. I genuinely enjoyed researching and knowing more because I had to write, you know.
Okay.
So
yeah,
I just followed my curiosity.
Yeah.
You know, okay, if I have to write about email marketing, okay, let's first understand what email marketing is. Oh, I really like this. Let's look at what more I can learn, you know. So it would be one single Google session which would spawn off multiple, you know, child Google sessions sort of thing.
I can understand.
So that is how that's how I realized I really like marketing more than I like technical. So start with the process, create samples on Medium, and follow your curiosity, follow where your heart takes you. And most important thing is look at improving your writing skill. Take suggestions, but also observe other writers, how they are writing. So if you are excited about customer service, read customer service blogs and see what are premier writers in those industries, what they are doing and how they are starting. Because wherever you are, you will always see the structure. You have been taught this intro, body and outro structure everywhere in the school. Think about it as your natural starting point. So what you will write as intro, what you will put in the body, what you will put in the conclusion, those are the things that are easiest to observe. Now, you don't need to start with intro because the intro needs to be very, very powerful. So you need to spend some time on it, right?
Okay.
I started writing intros, they come out very boring. But when I start writing the complete body, I get a sense of what the reader will get from the blog.
Okay.
I get excited about the content I have written. Right. So when I am excited about the content I have written, it's much easier to, you know, write an intro to get the reader excited about reading it, you know. And then it's just outro. Outro is just more like a summary plus with a CTA.
Got it. All right. So for any beginner, the important point to get started as a content writer is to have a portfolio for themselves. So without a portfolio, it's very difficult to land a job in the field of content writing because, you know, writing is a talent and you need to show proof that you're really a great writer. Only then you'll be able to find at least a full-time job or a freelance job, whatever it is. So to get started, you need to have a portfolio for yourself. And the best way to do that is to open a Medium account and start writing. It's free, right? So just to start writing whatever interests you and show that as a portfolio to land a job as a content writer. That's a great advice. Even, you know, that is how I started myself. So when I transitioned from a business analyst to a content writer, in order to show proof that I could write, you know, I had a blog for myself, and I also had a Medium account where I used to write. It may not be, you know, anything related to technical topics. It could be anything. Like, it could be an observation, a news article observation, or it could be anything that you're interested in. But just write and, you know, show that you are a great writer to land a job or to get started in this field of content writing. All right. So
I have just one more point to add here.
Yeah.
So, a lot of writers, they start off as fiction writers, or they start off, they like writing poetry.
Yeah.
So when it comes to writing B2B, the tone has to be logical. You know, your literary skills of creating fiction, of creating rhythm in your text, of basically storyifying things, can be useful, but not until and unless rest of the stuff around it is logical. So you need to think about what you can write about in a logical manner, you know.
Okay.
Especially when you're a beginner, you might think, okay, this field is quite hot right now, so I should start writing about it, you know. But when you look at the content that you are producing, it's still very, very fiction oriented, you know.
The style
looks less logical. It's not something that a B2B blog would want to publish on. So if there is something else that you can write, understand more logically, you want to explore because you are curious about it, start with that and select this way. Maybe use a month or something, get some reviews and see what is coming out positive and what people can actually understand from the content, you know. Because I remember, even as a trainer, HR person would understand what Java I was teaching.
Okay.
So I was good at explaining technical. So that skill, but I'm not a fiction writer. A fiction writer will have to develop that skill of talking logically.
Mm-hmm.
Only then your content will be logical. Only then your writing skills will be logical.
Got it. And, you know, talking about B2B content writing, how do you approach SEO writing? Because that's what people expect you to, write. Based on the SEO keywords, all that. So how do you approach SEO content writing?
I honestly thought SEO, on-page SEO, learning on-page SEO was quite easy for me.
Yeah.
Because it's just a matter of adding keywords in the title, in the headings, at the start, at the end, maybe somewhere in the middle. That's all there is to it in terms of on-page SEO. Now, how to create that depends on your English language skill. You know, you need to be able to create something, create a sentence or two in a way that does not sound stuffed. You know,
yeah.
It doesn't sound forced. How you can do that? There are so many things you can talk about. How do you talk generally? You talk. You make a claim, and then you prove it. You ask a question and then you answer it.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So there are so many ways to talk. Understand the substructures of writing, you know, and then you can create those substructures around the keywords that you have. So if someone tells me they need to write about what to post on Instagram, I will first search what to post on Instagram. I will not go to keyword research. I will first see what others have written. And then after I'm done writing the first draft, after I've done writing the second part of it, you know, the editing, if I've edited it, then I look at keywords and see where each of these keywords can be added, you know. So the key is to start off with your content, the way you want to write, and then add keywords. Don't try to create a narrative around the keywords. Sometimes I used to think that, yes, there all these are keywords must be there, so these all must be the headings of the that they want me to include. But keywords that you get are not outlines. You will create the outline. No. Keywords outline doesn't need to have those keywords, it just needs to have the topics that you are going to write. Keywords will come afterwards after you edit.
Correct, correct, yeah.
So don't try to create a outline out of keywords, you know, include them later after doing the edit, not just the first draft even, you know.
Got it. And yeah, I totally agree with that. And apart from, you know, adding keywords, I think optimizing the images with keywords and including videos or adding a lot of subtopics inside the blog is also very important when it comes to SEO optimizing the blog.
Yeah, a lot of content can be broken down into different types of media. There's always, visuals are always going to be, you know, the king when it comes to content types. Content is the king, video is the king of the content types, I would say. You know?
Yeah.
So you can add videos, you can add images, you can add screenshots. And of course, all text images are also part of on-page SEO. I missed mentioning that before. All text of images, caption of images is also a good way to put some kind of keywords.
Yeah.
As long as you can make it not post and make it out in a sentence, complete logical sentence.
Right. Got it. So let's talk about, you know, getting B2B SaaS clients, right? So since you're a freelancer with a niche, which is B2B SaaS, so can you tell us a little bit about how to land clients? Like, what are some of the best practices you follow to land clients?
Okay. I started off on Upwork, like a lot of beginners, Upwork and Fiverr. I had gotten my very first client on LinkedIn. But when I asked where that person found me, and in those days, I was not active on LinkedIn at all. I was just browsing and consuming content. I did not know anything about content creation. I did not know anything about personal branding or anything whatnot. So I was just browsing. One day I got this message from a guy. Okay. And he said me, okay, I'll offer you this particular rate. It was better than any other person was offered. So I said, okay, let's start and let's see how it goes. And I asked him, how did you find me? He said, you found me on Fiverr.
Oh,
so he took my name out of Fiverr and he searched on LinkedIn.
Yeah.
Clients can come anywhere. You need to maintain your online presence, at least for inbound. You know, if you are going to attract people, you need to be visible first.
Right.
You know, whether it is Fiverr, whether it is Upwork, or whether it is, I wouldn't recommend anyone to use freelancer.com because it's the crappiest site, frankly. Sorry for the language. But it is the most useless site. Upwork is still better, but it's more expensive. But if you're doing outreach, there are two types of outreach. One is going across Upwork projects and applying to it in the proposal. You need to learn how to write a great persuasive proposal where your samples can find strength. You know, there's no point in applying to 100 different projects and then coming out and saying zero converted. Of course, if you write 100, that means you're not personalizing it. You are not providing any value. There are thousands of others who are also providing that kind of, who are also writing much better proposals. So you need to highlight your skills and you need to find projects where your skills would be the best. So if I'm writing about music, I wouldn't probably enjoy. I would probably more be suitable. My experience would more be suitable for a tech project or a marketing automation or a sales automation kind of a project. So if that is the case, I can easily prove it. That means my conversion chances increase. That is one. When you're approaching to someone on LinkedIn directly without knowing their project ask, you know, project or task, don't say, please give me work. You know, that not only sounds desperate, that looks a little unprofessional as well. Because the person doesn't know who you are. They don't know what kind of work you do. You know, you and I have a context. You have seen my work. I have seen your work. And we have talked a little bit before. You know, so you need to have that kind of context. They should know who you are. So first things first, write samples and send links. Ask them to read and write great titles so they read it. Maybe follow up once or twice a week, but if they don't reply, leave them alone. Find someone else to send it to. Ask for reviews and see what kind of client you have. then after they say, they point out, this is your strength, this is, they really liked it, then you can take the conversation forward and say, I write this and this, I noticed that your company is also writing, if you have any more work, please let me know.
Yeah,
and please cool. Don't hang around after saying the, pitching that, you know. You find 10 exceptions. I just posted about this the other day. If you are getting a lot of rejections, it is your fault in the way, because in a way, because you are not finding the right projects where you would get acceptance. You can balance rejection with exception. You know, 10 rejections would hurt, 50 rejections would hurt, but 50 rejections with 20 acceptance would not hurt. You know, okay, it only takes one or two great clients to feel good about your work, you know, to feel good that you are earning money from it, you know. So look at it from a slightly more positive angle. Look at what you are getting accepted for and how you are getting accepted for first, at least when you are starting out. That's how my approach would be, you know, balance rejection with acceptance.
All right. Got it. So you said, you know, you need to show them samples, right? Even after sending samples, people ask you to write a sample content for them, right? So how do you approach that? Do you go on to write the sample?
At this stage, I probably would not write a sample if it is too long. If it is 400, 500 words, which I can crank out in say an hour or two, that's fine. I would not be spending more than that. I am frankly, given the kind of jobs that I applied to, my samples are enough at this stage. Now, coming to as a beginner, I did write samples and I did get ghosted a lot after writing. Not a lot, maybe at least a little I was ghosted, but fortunately, my samples were good enough that they elicited replies from people.
Okay.
You know, so
okay.
That's when I figured out there's also a chance that they are just asking for samples just to steal the content. You know, they could just copy paste it, put it in a new document and publish it and ghost you completely. That is possible. That happens very much. So what I did, I went into Google, I submit via Google Docs. And there's a mechanism where you go into the settings, you click share. There is a gear icon at the top right that opens up two settings. One of those settings is allow viewers to download and copy my content. So if that is activated by default, you know, that is one setting. And second is allow editors to add more, share the document with more people, something like that. Both are activated by default. You need to go to that share button, click the gear icon, and then disable both of those. Because when you do that, the link that you send will be just a fully read-only link. You know, and they cannot copy it. That's even better than a PDF, because PDF can be converted into a Word doc.
Word document, you know? Yeah.
So if those two are activated by default, they can read it, but they can still copy paste the content. You know, so when you, or they can download it and then copy paste it. But when you disable the download, they cannot do anything.
Got it.
You know?
Yeah, this is
That's what I realized. That's a trick that I realized to stop getting my content from them.
Got it. This is very interesting. Yeah. All right. So, like what rates can beginners charge their clients? Like any advice on the commercials?
Commercials, if I knew the industry as well as I know now, I think there are rates, there will always be business for writers that start at 25 paise per word. To writers that start at 1 paise per word. So you will probably not start at 50 if you don't have experience. That is where samples come in. If you get good comments from people who are honest with you, Because if you send it to your husband or wife, of course they'll be afraid of trying to hurt your feelings. So they would probably be, you know, probably even sugarcoat it in some way. As long as, unless you don't have that kind of chemistry with them, they can be honest and give you constructive criticism, you know. So anyone who tells you they liked something about it, it's a good feedback. Anyone who said well done is probably not the best feedback, because it's not giving you much to work on. You know, that's where your conversations with those industry experts whom you're sending your articles to as a reference, that can help. Use those conversations to get feedback. See what's working and what's not working. That will tell you where you should start. Now, in terms of rate, I firmly believe that no writer should start below 50 paise. There are a lot of other writers who will say, no, 50 paise is too low, start with 1 rupee, because 50 paise is still peanuts. Some people say it's not PPW is not paise per word, it's peanuts per word.
Okay.
But I have seen the industry. There are people who are asking for 10 paise per word also. So immediately starting at 1 rupee would probably be a little bit of too much for them, unless your samples are that exceptional.
Okay.
And I would say start at 50, unless your content is so exceptional that you can directly start at 1. I myself didn't get my first 1 rupee per word client until 2018, and that only came after 2 years of writing. Until then, I was writing less than 1 rupee per word and I was not making as much. So once you get a 1 rupee client, look at other clients who can get you published. Published samples are much more valuable, much, much more valuable. That's the thing beginners don't realize. You know, if you get published samples on Medium is one thing, but when you get published, when I got published samples, something like EngageBit, it's a legit site who has agreed to publish, who has trusted in my skills. So it's a kind of a social proof also, you know.
Yeah.
When you create landing pages, we put those logos. Why? Because they will give a social proof. Same thing with externally published articles outside of Medium, non-self-published.
Got it. Okay. And I also heard about scammers and brokers in the freelance industry. So do you have any pointers on that?
Always verify the profile. You know, I'm a part of a lot of Facebook groups which have now gone down the drain. People keep posting content where the profile is not even seen properly, and then they don't even read what they are posting, and they just want to apply to everything.
Okay.
Now understand that writing is a creative approach. It's a creative discipline. You know, it's a creative art. So it's not a numbers game. You know, if you come from a commerce background, or if you come from a business oriented background, you might think the more I apply, the more chances of success. It sounds simple to, it's easy to understand, but it doesn't scale as well. So first go and see whether the person has any reviews about them anywhere. If they have a website of their own, that means they are more genuine. If they have they're asking for samples and the email that they're giving is a website of their own. Say if someone from Hippo Video, Piyush from Hippo Video asked me, his ID would be, he would pay piyush@hippovideo.io. So that's much easier. That's genuineness verified. Go to the website and check. You know, how legit they are, what's the vibe that you are getting, you know. But of course, you cannot always rely on vibes, because your intuition can also, because they can easily fool you. So go to their website, go to their Facebook profile, see if they have enough details for it filled out. When was their latest post? Is it too old? Have they intentionally locked their profile? Does their header look genuine? Is it a business only profile? Because a lot of people, they have their own personal Facebook profile, they have their own business profile only.
Okay.
I wouldn't deal with business profiles. I have zero trust. There are a lot of, but there are other places where business profiles tend to be completely scammy, but there are some business profiles who are very genuine and they give you, they treat you well. At least they don't treat you like a handkerchief. So find profiles and find reviews. Look at reviews. You know, and if someone scams you, please post on social media. That's the most important thing, because others also need to know to save, save this number and away, stay away. And if you see someone posting whose negative review who you have already read, so if say X person is, I saw his X person's post one day and they were talking about this Y client who scammed them. Now the next day I see Y client asking for more writers.
Okay.
Right. So I know, I would tell people this, this is a scam client and our reviews have been posted. If I have time, I can also copy paste the link over there, you know, but if you don't have time, you don't need to do that, but make sure you keep informing everyone of these scammers. That's okay. More important, because people will start sort of, there is a level of trust when you help people verify some things, you know, there is a level of authority in that also.
Got it. All right. So we have reached the end of the episode, but before I wrap it up, what do you do apart from content writing? I know writing is your hobby and passion, but is there anything else that you do apart from writing?
I think I would, I have talked about tennis before a lot. I when last year, or rather in 2019, I was looking at, I was going through a weight loss process when I decided that I wanted to pick something that felt natural to me, that I could continue for long. Now, physical activity, the most common physical activity people were doing was this, weight training. They would go to the gym, they would pump weight, they would pump iron, and they would get buff in 6 months or something like that. And then they would lose it all. I didn't want to go that way, because I had done it before and I thought I could not find discipline in it. So what comes naturally to me is tennis. I understand tennis very easily, because I have been watching tennis since Sania Mirza stepped onto the scene in 2005. It became a natural choice. What will help me stick longer to a physical activity? Because in the long run, gaining weight or losing weight is about how calorie in, calorie out. So if I have to increase my calories out on a consistent basis, it would be better to stick with something that I can feel attracted to, you know. So for me, that is tennis. I play tennis every morning now. It's been 2 years, it's been 1.5 years that I've been very consistent with it, and I'm improving my game, and it has become a hobby and it's become a part of my life now, you know. And I try to see everything in life from a tennis point of view. So if you lose a client, or if you don't get a rejection, don't even get a rejection, because some clients, they take samples and they ghost you. You know, it's very hard to bring yourself to, you know, to that emotional equilibrium where you can ignore that happened, you know. But in tennis, if you lose a point, you cannot stay down. You have to get up. You have to play to a level. You have to be not aggressive, but you have to be present. You cannot just put a serve in and then let go, you know. You have to fight. So that fighting attitude, I think I have learned a lot from tennis. So other than that, I watch a lot of YouTube videos of my, I have a whole populated watch later playlist, which I just pick up any day in the morning. I enjoy consuming content about American politics, and Trump got me in it, but there are some specific, very specific channels on YouTube who are creating a lot of good content in terms of, you know, whom for politics is not more about exploration as marketing, you know, it's more about who can give you that confirmation bias wala feeling.
Okay.
Right? So I follow those channels who create great, who not only agree with me, but they, whom I agree with, but they also create very good content.
Okay.
So
okay,
I follow, there are a couple of channels I could mention. I'm not sure if audience can relate to it. There's a channel called The Ring of Fire. There's David Pakman show I follow, and MSNBC also is doing great coverage. Ever since the 2020 election, I started following them. So I am a big fan of American politics. Other than that, I one final thing I would mention is stay connected to your roots. You know, I am a Sindhi guy, and I love this. I have grown up speaking Sindhi. English is more of a natural second language for me, but it's not even a second language now. I think in English, I talk to my coach sometimes in English. So it is, for me, it's important to stay connected to my Sindhi language. I don't want to, like, 10 years down the line, once I have to talk Sindhi and then I would forget something. I fear that would happen. So what I do is I talk to my extended family every once in a while, because they are all in Ulasnagar, they are pakka Sindhi. Then it's not in Sindhis, if you are in the city, it's very hard to find people who actually speak Sindhi. They are Sindhi, but they will speak with their children in Hindi. So that's why best way for me is try to talk to my extended family every once in a while, because I need that familial connection, and I need to know that my mother tongue is not forgotten in my head. You know.
Got it. Yeah. Got it. All right, Naveen. So we have reached the end of the episode. But before I wrap it up, let's do a quick rapid fire. We have like 5-10 minutes of time. So we'll just do a quick rapid fire. I'll ask you 4-5 questions. That's it. Okay. All right. So the first question is, who do you follow the most on LinkedIn?
Who do I follow the most?
Yeah.
I think there is John Bonini of Databox, who creates a lot of great content. Unfortunately yet to be subscribe to his letter, but I will soon. But John Bonini from Databox and Dr. Theo, Erin Balsa, all of them are great content marketers. You know, the way they explain, they have a very good grasp on content marketing.
Super. All right. And the second question is, what works best? Is it videos or text-based content?
I am biased towards text, but I would say video is indispensable. You know, there's only so much people will ever read. You know, I am a voracious consumer of video. So I would say 60% text, but 40% video. And without video, you cannot do.
Got it. All right. So let's say, you know, hypothetically, you're getting your career started. So what would you tell to yourself? What advice would you give to yourself if you were getting your career started?
Improve your skills first. You know, pricing will come, but be grateful to the clients who are actually paying you for your work. You know, sometimes after writing for 3 to 4 weeks, you can say, oh, I'm writing very well. I'm enjoying this a lot. So let me increase my price. That it doesn't work that way. It's easier to think that way, but it doesn't work that way. So be grateful to the client when you're giving work, and learn about pricing. Learn about pricing strategies. There's a channel on YouTube called The Future, without the E, F-U-T-U-R. And that guy talks about pricing in a way that's the most captivating thing I've learned. You know, you learn a lot and you enjoy the way he's talking. So learn about pricing, be grateful to the clients.
All right. So the last question is, what's that one advice you want to give it away to our listeners? What's the one advice you want to give it away to our listeners?
Oh, this is such a broad question. follow your curiosity, I would say.
Okay.
Follow your curiosity, because I'm talking, the whole interview was mostly around beginners. I would say follow your curiosity and write. Just write. You know, express.
Write a lot.
Take it as an art rather than a way to make money.
Okay, got it. That's really great. All right, Naveen. So this was absolute fun. Thank you so much for spending your time with me today. I'll give you a LinkedIn link in the description so people can connect with you later. And yeah, it was nice talking to you, Naveen. Talk to you again.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for inviting me. I had a really good time talking to you. I did not know it would go this long. But yeah, thanks for inviting me. I hope readers, your listeners would find some value in this.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. All right, Naveen, talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Nice talking to you.